second highest peak that may have killed as many as a dozen climbers.
As many as a dozen Everest of them were caught out in a collapse of an ice ledge just beneath the summit.
Straddling the border of Pakistan and China, K2 is slightly smaller than Mount Everest, but its reputation has always been much larger.
K2, the second largest and most deadly mountain on the surface of the Earth. With unforgiving weather and exceptionally steep slopes, this mountain earns the status of being far more dangerous than Everest ever will be. Residing on the Pakistan-China border, K2 sits at 28,251 feet above sea level, only slightly smaller than its older brother. Thousands of climbers have scaled Mount Everest, whereas very few mountaineers dare challenge K2, where cerebral edema and harsh conditions dominate the region. 80 bodies of climbers still reside on the mountain, forever frozen in their expedition for the summit. Only 306 climbers have scaled the mountain, as opposed to the thousands that have reached the Everest peak. K2 is truly a force to be reckoned with. K2 was first conquered in July of 1954, a year after the first successful summit of Mount Everest. An Italian team led by Ardito Desio, labeled the Karakorman Expedition, set out to summit the world's harshest mountain. The two climbers that made it to the top, Lino Lassadelli and Achille Campagnani, would go down in history books as the men who conquered K2. But the expedition would soon grow into a high-argued point of controversy. The two climbers had established a camp in higher altitude than what was agreed upon by two other members of the expedition and resulted in near loss of life. The two climbers, Mehdi and Banati, were left overnight above 8,000 meters with no shelter or oxygen. Efforts were made in the 1950s to suppress the controversial idea that it was deliberate to secure the reputation of the Italian national heroes. The two Italians that first summited K2 are still slandered to this day, but held as national treasures in the eyes of the Italian populace. The next successful attempt wouldn't be made until 1977 by a Japanese expedition led by Achira Yoshizawa. In the years since the first summit, the dangers have gained more recognition, and rich tourists do not flock to this mountain the way they do with Everest, because life really is on the line, even more so on K2. August 1st, 2008. This day will forever reign in infamy as being the most deadly hours in K2's history. 11 mountaineers perished in a series of accidents due to lack of experience, equipment, and manpower. On July 31st at midnight, Sherpas began to set down fixed rope in preparation for a summit attempt the following day at 3 a.m. But a critical error was made in the rope's placement. The ropes were coming on way too early where the need for rope support was not present. Just below the summit, sitting at 8,000 meters, the bottleneck is the most dangerous part of the mountain. The terrain is exceptionally steep and requires immense strength and focus from the climbers. Towering over this area are seracs, massive, 100-meter-high ice walls that could break at any moment's notice. Many climbers have much respect for the seracs, as they are the driving authority and judge of experience.
Everything is raw. It's glaciers, it's black mountains. It fills you with respect.
Just above the bottleneck is where the climbers ran out of rope. This created a very dangerous situation where they are now waiting hours for lower ropes to be cut and placed above for continuation. 8 a.m. As the climbers began to advance, Dren Mandic from the Serbian team attempted to pass Cecilie Skog of the Norwegian team. Mandic then unclipped himself from the fixed rope and tried to pass. As he moved beside Skog, he lost his balance and began to fall down the mountain face. Mandic fell about 100 feet down the bottleneck. The hiker sustained fatal injuries from the fall and was later found with no pulse. The situation was now, how are they going to get the body down the mountain? A small group decided to attach rope to the body to slowly slide him down to the camp below. With extra weight at these altitudes and harsh terrain, this is an extremely difficult feat. Shaheen Beige from Pakistan was one of the individuals that assisted in the descent. Beige lost his footing, bumping into Swede Frederick Strang, and slid down the steep terrain and disappeared off the ledge.
Jiyan Beige from Pakistan suddenly started acting really weird. He's coming down on my right side, holding onto the rope, which goes around my lower legs. and we are crying out.
Release the rope! Release the rope!
He did not make one single move to stop his fall.
Jesus Christ.
Instead, he just let go. And it shoots off like a rocket straight out to the open air and just disappears.
His death is credited to high-altitude cerebral edema. High-altitude sickness causes hemorrhaging in the eyes and releases fluid into the brain, making coherent decisions difficult. In the death zone, which is located above 8,000 meters, this is the biggest killer on the mountain. Exhausted climbers will sit down, and it is very difficult for them to continue under this condition. They may never get up. After delays in regrouping to discuss what to do, the group decides to press onward for the summit. 18 people reached the second highest peak in the world that day, but only a handful of that 18 would be able to live to tell the story. The climbers began their descent down the mountain. 8:30 p.m. The summit and Bottleneck are now engulfed in darkness as the teams attempt to make their way down to Camp 4. As three climbers made their way down the Bottleneck, the seracs above the terrain collapsed and overwhelmed Norwegian mountaineer Rolf Bay.
The last thing I saw was Rolf's head torch moving. And then it was dark.
Bay, as well as the fixed ropes through the Bottleneck, were completely swept away. This is a very dangerous situation. A descent through the Bottleneck with no fixed ropes is a death sentence to every climber except the most elite. The remaining climbers would have to free solo down the mountain at the steepest altitude with ice axes and clamp-ons. Panic ensues with the group above the Bottleneck. They were unable to find the fixed ropes in the darkness. Completely unaware of what had occurred, they decided to wait till morning before searching for the ropes again. Several mountaineers from the Korean, Irish, and Norit died on the way down the Bottleneck. Italian semi-soloist Marco Confrontola passed Hughes Abadari, who had run out of oxygen and continued down the mountain with his ice axe. Marco would later witness Hughes falling to his death. Marco recalled hearing rumbles and seeing headlights disappear down the mountain. In this situation, you need to press on, or you will become another victim of the mountain. A few of the remaining 8 climbers that waited above the Bottleneck decided to attempt the descent under altitude sickness and lack of oxygen tanks. The others were left sitting and waiting for hypothermia to overwhelm their bodies. They sang and beat their fists to deter from falling asleep because they knew they would never wake up. Rescue attempts from base camp were made to rescue the climbers that were still trapped in the Bottleneck region, unknowing that many of the climbers had died. A rescue was soon attempted to reach 3 members of the Korean team above the Bottleneck. They had been overwhelmed by a serac fall and were barely hanging on to life as rescue came. The few that did survive the K2 disaster were able to free solo back to Camp 4, sustaining life-threatening injuries and sickness. A few of the 11 survivors were airlifted from lower camps due to frostbite and were taken to nearby hospitals. There was immense confusion about what had actually occurred. Everyone had a different story of several locations, and arguments ensued on what caused this catastrophe. There would not be another K2 summit until 2011. Many of the survivors went on to publish books on the ordeal. This was truly one of the greatest stories of mountaineering survival and of death. This story will forever bring light to K2's massive reputation, a force to be reckoned with. This short documentary is personally dedicated to the fallen souls of K2.